Hey, how's everybody doing? My name is Chopper Dave, undercover guy that runs behind the scenes and gets all the good stuff done. And I got a good story. We call it the Brooksville Rodeo story. It's similar to the Chillicothe Biker Rodeo, which a lot of people have heard of. But the Brooksville Rodeo is called the Party in the Pasture, where we get these custom bikes out there, such as this. Of course, people kind of lean towards this thing here because it's 10 foot long, and you can do so many things. When you pose a girl on a bike like this, you can stretch them out and put them in all kinds of compromising positions. Well, when you're at a biker rodeo, it's called the Party in the Pasture on private property, you can get a girl, which we do and did, you get her sprawled out of here butt naked posing with the boobies hanging out, and then you get her to doing a side pose with the legs spread out. I mean, it's just no holds barred. And of course, we're all drinking liquor, hard liquor usually, and you know, just things just go flying and you just never know what's going to happen. And that's what we call Party in the Pasture, where it's no holds barred and you're just having all kinds of fun, and everybody's wishing they was there when they see the pictures of the after effects. It's like, man, I missed it. I wish I was there. So that's just a day in the life of Chopper Dave and the boring lifestyle that we get to lead.
Should we start it off with, and that was our landlord?
And that was our landlord.
Yeah.
Who lives in Florida and lived in this house, which we now call the Aberplex, for 20 years or so before we moved in. And anyways, he comes up like once a year during the summer for like 3 weeks. And the funny thing was, I think the build-up made the entire story actually a lot funnier. Because the build-up was last year when we were expecting him. I think we were all a little bit on edge about how he was going to react to the way the house looked. And, you know, like the fact that it was obvious that we partied in it and never cleaned it once. And so we cleaned up a whole lot and made the house look really good. And we even like scrubbed like a shitload of like paint off of the kitchen wall in the other kitchen. And so we made the place look really good. And then he came into town on his fucking motorcycle that you saw, if this all goes in that order. And he comes in on his motorcycle and he talks about how he just got done motorboating this bitch at this titty bar. And this is like 3 in the afternoon too, and he just got done doing that. And he was like, I was all like, and like, that's exactly how he said it. No, like, actually how he said it was, he was like, hey baby, I just got in Ohio, how about a nice motorboat? And I was like,
and that was kind of funny afterwards. He started like as if we didn't know what a motorboat was, he started telling us how to do it. Like,
yeah, he explains to us how to do a motorboat. So that's our first impression of our landlord. But while he was in town the first time, he wants to go drinking with us. And so one of us said the trolley stop, we suggested going there with him, because that's just one of the bars that we like going to. And so we go to the trolley stop, and Dave sneaks in. We're sitting on the patio.
He
sneaks in a whole jar of moonshine, and he just sets it on the table. And it's weird because we don't really want to like drink the moonshine, because it's like we don't want to like piss off the bar, but we don't want to say no because it's our landlord. So we're like kind of feeling pressured to drink this moonshine by our landlord. But we do anyway, so we're like passing this jar around, and it's awesome, we're having fun. And then the guy from the bar comes out, and he picks up the fucking jar, and he's like, dude, you can't have this. And you're like, what are you thinking, right? And so he walks him out with it, and Dave pleads with the guy to let him keep it, and he takes it back to his truck. And when Dave comes back into the bar, he sits down with us and he apologizes for what just happened, and he's all embarrassed. And we're just like, Dave, that was the coolest shit you could have ever done. Like, as our landlord, it was just a great story. So we were stoked about it. But then the next year, I think you should take it over with Trolley Stop 2.
Yeah,
Trolley Stop 2011 with Dave.
A few days ago, actually. He asked us all to go out to a bar, And again, we said, how about the trolley stop? And we got there this time, and it was more packed than I've ever seen it. So we decided to go out on the patio. And well, earlier that day, he told me that he's going to bring his laptop and show me some pictures of the girl that he had naked in our jacuzzi. And about her hangers, which I think were supposed to be her boobies. So I figure he's gonna show us like a few pictures,
like 4 or 5 maybe.
And so he starts showing us these pictures of all these girls that he's been with, and kind of making us a little jealous. And about an hour and a half later, he finished showing us all these pictures. And everyone on the patio got to see him too.
Yes, because he had his laptop out, and he was like, he would look at it, and then he would introduce it, like he would say, like, "Oh, this is a drip. Oh, this here's a drippy twat." Oh.
You're about to go
do
swimming,
this
boys.
And show the pictures to us, but the whole patio's behind us too, so everyone just sees these like disgusting, like hairy pussies on this guy's computer, and we look like. We look like we're students or something. Like, we're learning what it is, you know?
Yeah, that was our second introduction to him.
God, that was hilarious. And the funny thing about how long that went, too,
yeah,
was that Jake was the one that knew he was going to do that. And he told Jake he would bring these pictures. And while we, when we got there, we all sat down. We had, like, most of a beer. And then Jake went inside to go get a beer. And then Dave pulls out his computer. And he's showing us these pictures, and he's, like, saying hilarious shit, and it's awful. And I'm sitting here going, like, shit, Jake's gonna miss the entire thing, because he's already shown us, like, 6 photos, and I figured that was it, too. And that just, I guess, kind of emphasizes how many more it was than we expected, because he went on for an hour and a half. But
was it really an hour and a half?
It was an hour and a half.
It was an hour and a half.
Hello again, here we are in this historic house full of awesome musicians right now. And this house was built in 1918. It has such a rich history, and so many people have lived here, partied here, and sold flowers, you name it, people have done it. And I've got a great story. When we were working together, my partner and I was working here doing business, and we had a lot of people. There was a lot of people coming and going, you know, socializing, coming through. We were just dialoguing with them. So anyway, this one guy, he's going to the bathroom in the blue room. Yeah, we call it the blue room with the blue fiberglass tub that went through the window. So anyway, so this guy's sitting on the throne in the bathroom. And you know he's on the throne because that's what he's doing. He's not in there for a quick 10-100, so... So he's on the throne. Now we had this air horn they used on boats, me and my partner, and we cut on this guy all the time. My partner would fold him up on the couch. He was a string bean. He was like 6 foot tall but skinny as all get out. And he would just raise hell with him and fold him up on the couch in this room back here. So anyway, he's sitting on the throne. His name was Steve Turpin. And he's sitting on the throne. My partner grabs this big old air horn, sneaks up to the bottom of the door rail on the bathroom, and then just lets it loose, lets that air horn rip loose, and it's like, you know, it's huge. And as soon as he does that, you hear this thump, 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 thump. The guy falls off the commode, and you can't see it, but you know by the sounds, he falls off the commode and hits the floor, and it's a tile floor. And you knew what happened to him. It just took him off guard, and just, I mean, we were just laughing our asses off because you know what happened behind that closed door, even though you couldn't see it.
Yeah.
The guy hit the floor, and there was probably shit flying everywhere. And we were just laughing our asses off, and he never, you know, it was just one of them Kodak moments. If we had video on it, it would have been... We could all be a millionaire just from selling that freaking video.
that's awesome.
Just one of many stories in this awesome house that has got rich history to it.
Now, Dave, just remember, you know, we play weird, loud, obnoxious punk rock.
right. That was tight, man.
Hi. So this is a story about how I met my coworker's mom. We were at this bar over here,
Shags,
and they have little like cup holder things. And they say, you know, I'm the designated driver. Hi, how are you doing? I'm the designated driver. There's like millions of these little coasters that say it on. Me and my buddy Brandon over there, we're drunk. We get a marker and we start changing stuff. Hi, I'm the designated fucker. Hi, I have herpes. Hi, I suck dick. We just did a whole bunch of these and just put them back in the stack so the bartender would hand them out to people. And we're at the bar and there's like a backside of the bar where there's like pool tables and stuff. And we hear this old lady go, "Where's all the dicks in here? Where's the dicks at?" And we're just laughing. We didn't think anything of it. This lady comes up to us and she sees that we're riding on these coasters and she picks one up. She's like, "Oh yeah, I'm the designated fucker tonight." And her daughter's there and her mom is there, who's like 90. They're all just hammered. God. And she's just going on and on, sticking these coasters down her shirt. And you're just being belligerent. And we're just laughing. Whatever. She goes, sits down. One of my employees at work walks into the bar. I'm like, "Hey man, what's going on? What are you doing?" He's like, "Oh, meeting my mom up here for a beer." I was like, "Oh, that's cool." He walks straight up to this lady that was screaming about dicks 5 minutes before that. And I was like, "Dude, that's your mom?" He's like, "Yeah." I was like, "You realize she was screaming that she wants dicks really loud like 5 minutes ago? She also let us know that she's the designated fucker and that she doesn't have herpes, so you got that going for you." The entire next week, dude, I just gave this guy hell at work. He was pissed.
That's hilarious.
That I met his mom at Shag's.
I think I do remember that story.
Yeah, that's
Bright, you don't have to stare at it.
All right, this is a great story about the fence, this brand new fence right here that we just put up like a week ago or so. And my best friend, Crazy Man Mark, helped me. After we got it put up and erected, my truck is parked right in front of the fence here. And I'm across the street talking to the Archie guy, which is a Christian guy, you know, so very conservative type man. And Mark's standing by my truck, and he opens the passenger side door and stands in front of it to block him. I'm sitting there talking to this guy across the street, and Mark just waves his hand and starts laughing. He whips out his meat and starts slinging his meat back and forth while I'm trying to have a civilized conversation with Mr. Christian over here. Now, needless to say, I'm dead in the air. I stop talking because I can't believe what I'm seeing. This guy's fucking whipping his meat out and slinging it around while I'm trying to talk to this guy. And all I can say, the guy's wondering why I stopped talking in mid-sentence, obviously. And all I can say, and of course he whipped it back in, so the guy didn't see his meat whipped out. He did it real fast, you know, when he wasn't looking. All I could say, I had to point my finger across the street and say, "I'm sorry I stopped talking, but this guy over here, he's a nut."
welcome to the illustrious BHA space, also known as Astrofang HQ. If you go ahead and follow me, we'll give a grand tour. To this direction, you'll see our wonderful touring vehicle. This is the van. Come on, but don't take my word for it. You'll notice here, this is private property. There is no trespassing, so just this once will allow you to. This is the death trap. We call it the BHA death trap. It's really dark in there. You could fall and potentially damage your body.
Please flush.
get in the van. Go ahead and follow us to our van, man. Are you filming?
Yeah.
I'll show you to our van.
Turn off your car, Brian.
Right.
You got to save energy.
You gotta look out for number one.
Green energy. We'll let you sit in the driver's seat. You're the sober one. What about the night that we found the branch in the park and walked with open steel reserves at 7:30 in the morning?
Yeah, to celebrate our friend's birthday, we crashed a party, and he was like, we're like, what do you want to do? And he's like, well, I want to get some 40s and drink out of the bridge like a homeless guy. And I'm like, all right, sounds good.
This is a totally different night.
No, it's not. But instead, we got Four Loko and picked up a branch and walked it 3 miles.
It was at least a 50-foot branch.
It was a good branch. It was a good-sized branch.
And then we took it in Randy's house.
And we put it... He only has one room. It's a very small apartment.
That's pretty big. We fit the branch in.
We did fit the branch in, but it did take up all the space in the apartment.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was pretty good.
So we've got these Four Locos that... The sun is rising, and he's entertaining a gentleman. He's entertaining a gentlewoman in his room with a dog. And we walk in chanting, the sun is rising, and he's very upset about it.
What were we chanting?
I don't know. We were really drunk.
This is the branch behind all the madness of JB's birthday. And it did take up 80% of the apartment. Remember that time we had a pillow fight, but instead it was really just like cardboard tubes and we just kept whipping each other with it? That's not gay at all.
We could talk about our many times. We were naked too. We were completely naked. I feel like naked is a prevalent theme as far as Dayton goes.
Yeah.
There's a lot of nakedness.
There's a lot of nakedness.
A lot of public nudity. We used to be naked on the golf course, Brian. We were sledding. With a case of Ice House.
I thought it was Red Dog.
No, Red Dog. Was it Red Dog?
Don't even get me started on Red Dog.
So, yeah.
Well, you know, Mandatory Metallica was always a very vital...
Yes, we would have Mandatory Metallica and chug Red Dog as hard as we could.
We would place bets on what song from Metallica they would play first.
At Dylan's.
Yeah. And the guy who ran our label hated me, and he... kicked me in my balls one time. That was a little rough.
At Dylan's?
No, that was actually at the Pearl.
Why?
Dayton, am I right?
Yeah.
I feel like all of our wildest dreams came true out of town now.
Like the time I got a DUI in Dayton?
That's the one. Toads and Mice CD release.
Yeah.
I even tried to grab your keys that night. Did you know that?
Is this when we were leaving the party?
This is when you were leaving the Pearl.
I got kicked out because the person fed me a glass of whiskey because they liked me, and then they didn't like me after the whiskey.
And we kept grabbing that dude's butt because he enjoyed the man a little bit too much for our acceptance. We did not approve of his good time.
There was a time we tried to bring Complete to Dayton.
What about that time we broke into a church?
And the people came out?
Yeah. Okay, there's this time I didn't necessarily break into the church.
Well, I had an opening.
Well, you know, everyone else jumped in, and it was me and Christian's girlfriend at the time, and we kind of were dragging
were
our
there,
feet
Justin,
to get into this abandoned
Andy,
church.
Andy Ashbrook was there.
And this crazy crack whore walks up, and she was wearing nothing but a real crazy-looking zebra-like tube top and a Cincinnati Reds windbreaker. And she had, a pretend walkie-talkie in her coat, and she even made the sound effect. She was like, we got him! And we're like, what the fuck? So Sarah and I, Sarah being Christian's girlfriend, called everyone out. And then we ran out and she's like, I got him! I got him! Call 911! Call 911! Like, started flipping out and...
Didn't the guy come out with a baseball bat?
Yeah.
She had a board with a nail in it.
It was very...
He had a piece of plywood with
so,
a nail.
So, well, Sarah and I, we started just, bolting immediately, and then when the rest of the, group of people got out of the church and started walking back. A group of rednecks came up with a board with a nail in it. Christian, go.
in a baseball bat. I don't know. I just remember hiding, like, in a dumpster.
Our friend got thrown down, but then we got into a fight with him, like, a month later, so.
Oh, my God. There's a katydid in the car. Please look at that.
Well, we can't let this happen.
No! Brian, you just burnt the ceiling.
Look where it landed.
Well, we can't let that happen.
No, he's not a herder. He's not an evil bug. He just needs to get the hell out
of here. Just let him,
Just get him out of.
Alright.
It was my 21st birthday, not his.
And you were blackout drunk.
Thanks to some friends that I was in a band with.
They were very good friends to get you blackout drunk.
Right. It was a very well-promoted show. There were a lot of people there.
And we had to Sid Vicious your amp. I turned it down so low. And then
Brian kept composed. My friends got me blacked out hammered. I was too drunk to play the show. To this day, this band from Boston that we played with, every time they're like, oh, I remember you. It was your 21st birthday, right? And you got too hammered to play the show? Oh, that's cool. That's understandable. But what they don't know is that I just had a really bad drinking problem. The end. Well,
you won't believe this. We played a show and it was great.
Okay, the most shocking story I can think of. You would not believe this, but Astrofang, with all baggage set aside, there have been numerous times where we have played shows. They've gone extremely well. And they just went great, and that's all there is to it. We partied afterwards.
This is pathetic.
And
this is really pathetic.
All right, well, let's try it again. You would not believe this. There have been times when Astrofang would play a show.
Don't say our name. Just say when we
have. All right, one more time.
Just quit name dropping it.
Okay,
it sounds
stop.
Annoying.
Stop and start. There's one time.
Start now.
Okay, go.
Me? Action.
Okay.
You will not believe this.
You will not believe this. Astrofang.
No, oh. Just say we.
I don't want to do that.
You have to say
but we're so badass.
Oh, my God. No, we're not. You know what we do? We get our asses whooped on the reg daily by people that are constantly whipping our asses. Someone comes up and broke my knees with a baseball bat in Dayton. A crackhead was living inside of my car for upwards of 4 months without me ever even realizing it. You would not believe that. And you know why? Because it's not true. I've never had my ass beat, and there's never been a crackhead that lived inside of my car.
Why is your tooth chipped if you've never got your ass beat?
Because I got punched in the face, and then I T2'd him.
What does that mean? It
means I was a fucking amorphous blob of metal that fucking destroyed him.
I need a lighter. Super bad.
Shit. You can take that to the bank. Good night. This interview is over.
What's up, man? You want to hear a story? So I had a strange experience a few years ago. This would be the epic tale of Poopy Purse. So I was at this party, right? And there was this really, really drunk, nasty thing. I think it was a girl there. And man, this chick was just, she was hammered drunk, just looking for dick, just all kinds of dick everywhere. She just wanted dick, grabbing people's dicks, like all over the place. No one wanted anything to do with this girl, right? So, you know, after you grab one too many dicks, people start getting pissed off, you know? Retribution is at hand. So, one of my good buddies, Josh, decides to wait until this woman leaves her purse unattended. While she's off looking for dick, you know, Josh grabs her purse, walks upstairs with it, just takes the nastiest dump inside this purse that you've ever witnessed. It was foul. It was just disgusting. Just leaves it, and then, you know, leaves it in the kitchen, you know. few hours later, she's like looking for her purse, she's trying to get her cigarettes out, you know, and she's just still shit-faced wasted. No pun intended. So, she's going through her purse, right? She finds it, and she's trying to get her cigarettes. And, you know, she's kind of looking down at it like this, going through it, you know? And she's getting her hair all in it and shit. She has no idea that there's this steaming dump inside of her purse. She's getting it on her hands, she's trying to push her hair back, she's getting it in her hair and shit. Till finally, it strikes her. She's got feces all over her, and she is just pissed. Next thing we know, we see her storming out of the house. She's got her purse in hand, and as far away from her as humanly possible, she's like storming out of the house with this purse. So after that, she became known as the Poopy Purse. That was her nickname. That's what we call her now. And that is my epic tale of Poopy Purse. Thanks for listening.
Man, so the pooper story. So there's a little bit of controversy surrounding that because I specifically remember coming up out of the basement and seeing you pulling up your pants and the purse is on the floor. Steinberg swears that it was him, but I did not see him with his pants off. I saw Mike pulling up his pants with a purse in between his legs.
So, you know, for the record, the story that happened before that was I was peeing on the floor, and Steinberg held a glove up, and it was like...
No, that was in the basement.
I was playing the drums. I remember that. I was playing, and I looked up. And you were peeing in a glove that Steinberg was holding.
And it wasn't like a vinyl glove, it was like a cloth glove.
It was a utility glove.
The piss was just dripping right back out of
it. It was a utility glove, and it was just pouring out of the bottom, like the thumb of the glove. But as far as poop purse went, I have to say that I'm pretty confident that you were the one delivering the goods, not
that
Steinberg.
That makes sense. I can shit on command, and a lot of people can't.
That was the good part.
All right, so we were at a gas station, and we were all going inside to get some
beer.
How
recently was this?
This was probably about a year ago, maybe a little longer.
Oh, wow.
And I remember I got out of the car, and you were pumping the gas because you were driving, and there was a lady, an old lady, across the pump, next to us, and we start walking inside, and you're just talking to this old lady, and you're like, hey, hey, and she's like, what? Like, looks up, pumping her gas, she's like, what is it? She said, have you heard about the caterpillar movement? And she's like, what? He said, the caterpillar movement, have you heard about it? She said, no. And you said, well, they're just moving inch by inch, just to get somewhere. And then you walked away.
So this afternoon after band practice, we found this. Brad came over to film us, and this was in my yard apparently. I have no idea how it got there or who brought it there, but it's sweet, isn't it? Look at it.
Urban living at its finest.
Oh, and by the way, it does this.
Still got blood on it.
And it's rusty.
That's that. Blood.
It's blood or rust. I don't know. You know,
pirate blood.
Nobody can tell for sure.
It's dried pirate blood.
Pirate blood? Yeah, we're going to go with pirate blood. Because, I mean, we are the great ship Daytonia.
And we don't take any pretenders. You don't want to use that beer. It's dirty. That knife? No way. Somebody can sterilize it.
Either that or I'm going to use.
Oh my god. No.
That's cool. Did you shake anybody's
what?
Wiener? Right?
We don't know. We found it.
It was in my yard this morning. Or this afternoon when he filmed, when he came over.
Is that herpes?
I love this country.
I love this bar.
Alright, rock it out, Leo.
It's for your big ass mouth, Shane.
That's my mouth? What do I do? I'm gonna cut it.
That's an awesome way to tap a shotgun beer.
Can you believe that?
That is awesome. That might be illegal. I haven't done one in years.
Put your lips on it and roar!
Alright, you're gonna win.
Someone grab that last piece of pizza before it gets spread. What do you do? Crack you're gonna play
it?
Like a flute?
Okay.
Oh, fuck you. I'll play like a flute.
Oh, she's gonna beat you, dude.
Son of a bitch!
I didn't even finish it!
Leah!
Ah.
Champagne! Oh my
Tip
god!
Tip that!
She's on the
floor. That was like 4 seconds.
Damn! 16-ounce beer in 4 seconds.
Man!
That's why you have, that's why beer
yeah.
Guys, what is your problem?
Damn!
Thank you.
So 2 weeks ago, I was standing here and with a group of people, and the bar had already closed by Bob's, and I look over and I see someone standing over there in the doorway, and like, he looked like a slight version of Adam Sandler, Iranian, sort of bald, and he was looking at me with these like intense, like evil, demonic eyes or something. Something was like coming through him, I don't know. And I looked down and his dick is out and he's masturbating while he's staring at me with like demon eyes. And so I scream like a banshee and people start running towards him and he's trying to stuff it in his pants, I don't know. So he still is like looking at me and people are like pushing him away from me while he's staring at me, walking towards me the whole time. So there's some sort of, I don't know. I forgot. Cut it. Raina Nog walked by and gave me this weird look. Lost it. Oh, wait. Okay. So, yeah, they're pushing him away, and he's fighting through their pushes. Like, he's, like, still looking at me with, like, the devil in his eyes. And so finally one of them smacks his head on the concrete, which I'm all about, until we think blood is going to start pouring from his skull, and we can't call the cops for sexual assault, obviously. So he eventually starts just, like, walking on all hands, like, towards the exotic fantasies doorway. And it's pretty much when I knew that I could never date anyone in Dayton.
So the next day, I happened to see Lacey's stalker slash molester walking down the Oregon District, and I followed him to Blind Bob's as he sat down at the bar, still looking for his keys, which is ostensibly why he was hanging out in front of this fucking place. Excuse my French. And I confronted him and said, "You realize what you did last night?" He's like, "I don't know, man. I was pretty wasted." I said, "You whipped your fucking dick out and masturbated in front of an entire group of people, staring at my friend Lacey." And he said, "Oh, no, 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 man, I did not do that." "Well, no, I might have done that." literally, this is what he said.
Good luck.
So he's banned. He's going to have to do a lot of community service in my book, in this bar's book, to ever come back.
Such a lucky girl.
Yes.
So, my name is Bob, and I'm blind, and so I opened this bar called Blind Bob's. And when I first started to open it, I was catching some flack because people thought a place named Blind Bob's was making fun of blind people. But I actually reached out to the community and said, "Look, I really am blind, so it's okay for me to name this place Blind Bob's." And that actually came from this whole perspective that I was a little kid, and my grandfather lived next door to me, and he was blind, and it was one of those things that skipped every other generation. So I had a pretty good sense that I caught the gene, and I was lucky enough to be the one that was going to lose my vision in terms of my old age. So I always had this impression that if I went blind, I was going to open up a bar and have two bar stools in it. And I was going to sit in one of them, and I was going to be darn careful in who I let sit in the other bar stool. And then, lo and behold, when that became the eventuality, where I was declared legally blind, I thought, it's either put up or shut up. So I opened up this establishment in Dayton called Blind Bob's. And I got to tell you, I think it's pretty funny, and I've had nothing but a good time since we opened up the doors in terms of Blind Bob's. I appreciate the community, I appreciate the bands, and I gotta tell you, they say if life gives you lemons, make lemonade. God bless America, they let me open up Blind Bob's.
Okay, go. Emily's taking a shower, my roommate Emily. Kelsey and I fuck with Emily. And so I said, "Kelsey, I feel like we should do something to Emily while she's in the shower." So I found a scarf. And we tied one end of the scarf to the bathroom door and slammed it shut. And then ran the other end of the scarf into the kitchen, which is like right around the corner. And we tried to tie the scarf to the inside of the fridge, to the plastic piece, but the fridge is made out of plastic. So when we shut the door, the piece of the fridge broke off and clattered out on the floor. So then we ran it all the way into the kitchen and tied it to one of the cabinet handles and made sure that it was taut, and I'm the only person telling the story.
I get out of the shower and I realize, fuck, I'm locked in the shower. And I'm like, fuck you, Kate. I'm taking all your razors and get this unlocked. She's like, "No, Emily, you won't do that. Like, I will throw all of your shit into the toilet." And I was like, "Well, you guys, like, said I'll throw all of your shit into the toilet." She's like, "Well, how do you know I threw your shit in the toilet?" I was like, "Oh, I'll know."
She said, "It'll be wet, so I'll know." And I said, "What if I did it the day before and then it dries for a day and you
but
don't know what
I put home. I'm never not home for, like, not a day. Like, I'm always home at
so
some
if
point.
I stuck your toothbrush in the toilet, you wouldn't know that I stuck your toothbrush in the toilet?
How did I already stick your toothbrush in the toilet? What if I grabbed a cup of toilet water and poured it onto your bed? And you're just like, man, this bed feels extra wet. And I was like,
you want to know what Kelsey did the other night when she was shocked? I retook an entire ice cube of ice trays and cracked it over your bed and left all the ice cubes all over it.
Because I went out with Mia, so I didn't know.
Was your bed wet when you came home?
No, it was like dry, but I saw like little like marks, like it was marked. No, it was dry.
That's my sister.
So, you ready? All right, so this one time, we played at Cornerstone, we played with the Dirty Socialites, and a couple other bands. I didn't drink any liquor. I'm fucking wasted. So I didn't drink any liquor, and normally I have a shot or two before I fucking play. I told my friend's shot buddies, and then they all, like, a train of five people come to me with shots. I do all five shots. Bam, 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 slam all glasses down. I black out halfway through the set. This is how Dayton does it. Like, we just party. Like, fuck everything else. Dayton is the shit. I don't care.
We had a good time down here downtown. Drank an excessive amount, and you know, you get to that point where it's like you're either drunk and chill, or you know, you're in rage mode. We were in rage mode. We're like, hey, let's go around and just straight up. We're like, let's catch shit on fire. That was our only goal. We didn't care what it was. Started here. We started a little fire here on the patio, but shit went sour. Wasn't a good thing. My buddy's like, hey man, we can have people back over at my place. So we're like, okay, cool man. We started a fire in his backyard, and then you know that wasn't good enough. So we're like, dude, everything is an alleyway. We're like every alleyway here, dude, dumpster fire the fuck out of it. We found mattresses, couches, and just piled them all onto this one dumpster, man. Lit that shit, dude. Got wild. Breaking all kinds of stuff on it, you know, being stupid, not thinking about what was going to happen. So, like, of course, cops get called, fire department, they come out and put it out, and we're like, dude, fuck, we got to hide, you know, let's get out of here. Minutes later, the cops came and was like, so, did you guys happen to start this fire? I'm like, no, man, no way. They're like, well, neighbors told you that we did. You guys need to get out of here. Landlord came in like 30 minutes and said, you're not allowed to live here. You got to be out by 6 in the morning. Sucked for him. Sucked for him, but we had a badass time, and he wasn't upset about it. Never really got mad, so. That was something Dayton did. It was pretty rad.
Fucking real. And but the thing was, after he gave me a blowjob, I was so fucking happy. I was like, you know, I don't even care if that's not fucking the real deal or not.
Thank you. That makes me look good.
Yeah. Oh, and besides that, he's really good on the bass.
Besides him fucking me in the ass on the bass.
Well, believe me, I only heard you through one of my ears. You know what I mean?
I met this dude Jeff. He comes up, starts hitting on me, asked me if I was married.
I said
no fucking way.
So, right there, man. I remember.
So we went in the back and we had a good old, yep, there it is. That's what I did.
It's all except for it was mine.
And at the end of it, he took took his cowboy hat off at the end and flung it towards the camera because it was on film.
Oh yeah, that was to cover up when you were puking. But anyways, we had a great time together, and we will always be bonded in this way, like this. Come on, give me some tongue.
Boobs.
Bring it home, Randy. Bring it fucking home. I didn't sign up to lose.
I know that, but I think
you're distracting.
by her breasts.
Her mouth. Her mouth is open in this one. It's so fucking touchy.
You just tell me where to go and I'll hit it. How about that? You tell me where to go and I'll hit it.
You gotta help me. I can't find the last one.
Okay. Good game, girl. Good game.
I think he's a tranny hobo, and he's kicked out of the bar once before. And he tried to come in. I'm like, no, dude, can't come in. So he walked over here and started like hassling people at the fence. And he was like, there were these like British Royal Air Force soldiers here that night.
I didn't know.
And they were antagonizing him. So he like pulled down his pants, showed him his wiener, and then he like showed him his butthole. And I was like, dude, you got to get the fuck out of here, or I'm gonna drop kick you right in the butthole.
Okay, so this one like absolutely insane night. I went to Blind Bob's and I was standing here smoking my cigarette and drinking my Miller High Life. And this guy was filming this other guy, like doing like an interview. And I decided to get in the background, which was pretty awesome. And I mean, honestly, it's probably one of the best times I've ever had. I'm gonna be quite frank about it.
I'm Mission Man. I'm a rapper, local area rapper, and tour a lot. I love playing Dayton all the time. I do what I love all the time. So this is about doing what you love may seem out of reach, as dreams did not teach in the rhetoric of lesson plans. That's all we need to lend a hand. If you love to sing, just do your thing. Step up, grab the mic, forget about the stage fright and the strange lights. If you sing because you love it, then the audience will know, and it's obvious you grow as you take deep breaths and you make each step just a little bit smaller than the one before, until you can step up and knock it on the door. Get your foot in as soon as the door opens. Don't waste moments, hoping it never closes. Let them see the love in your eyes and then know you're not a lie. Just do your thing because it is no try. No matter what you love, just go out and do it. Don't let other people screw with your plans and your dreams or your hands they seem like they're losing the strength to hang on. Just do what you love and they'll always stay strong.
Boobs!
I feel like they show a lot more nip nowadays.
I can't see anything on this one.
I don't know, but look at her face.
Seriously, there's like hardly anything going on here.
Right.
There you go.
Right, there's really not much.
Oh my god, this one's
like it's something with her.
Yeah, it has to be something with her. This one's insane. Oh my god, you're doing it. How did you notice that? You're fucking nuts. Oh, that, yeah, there we go. Hey, there we go.
I love titties. What can I say?
I saw that one, okay.
Can you please include this?
No cream in her coffee.
My name is Kevin Hamilton. And one thing that I learned how to do in Dayton is to turn my stomach into an ass, and I'll show you it right now. And basically, when you've got the stomach, and this is my stomach, you can use your stomach. What you do is you take it and you bunch it together until it looks like an ass. And let me just do it for you really quickly.
Oh my god.
And then,
you
can let it, you can let it go, and then it'll go back to a stomach. But if you want to do it again, for maybe a friend missed it, and you want to do it again, you can just.
Oh my god.
And so I'm Kevin Hamilton, and that's how to turn your stomach into an ass.
Okay, so what's confusing is that when I've heard about Dayton, I hear that it's this steel industrial town that's really down in the dumps and disappointing and depressing, and this to me seems more like Bloomington, Indiana. Like, granted, we've only played on this cute little strip here, but it seems really nice and I really like it. Like, there's nothing about it that would seem less exciting than any other city we've been to. I even called my mom and said that. Oh, my name's Marnie Stern. Hi. But seriously, I called my mom and I said, you know, there are all these towns across the country that you have ideas of or don't even have ideas of, and then you get there and they're adorable and really cute and it's really cool people. And I guess, you know, some snotty people have this idea of the country of just these five major cities where everyone lives. But really, everyone is pretty cool in this person in particular. But there are people that are totally cool and awesome in Dayton.
It's not like we just put it in our pocket and go, oh, wait, we weren't doing nothing.
I think we might be taking too long a stroke.
Oh, there's a cop.
And he's not gonna notice the big ass fucking saw hanging out. He okay. Wouldn't. There you go, hell yes!
Who said that?
Jeremy.
Hey! That guy with a saw!
We're firing pearls at you, man. We're all Yuma. I'm Tyler. This is Brian Saunders. And John Gassett. And Jen Selhorse. And we are Roley Yuma.
So we all lived at the Vine Street house on Vine Street in Dayton. And where it was all of us. We were all in the same room for something. We were part. Well, I think we were watching Rachel getting married.
We were. So, that's what we were doing.
And yeah, we were watching Rachel getting married. It's a really good movie. So we're hanging out, right? And there's a knock on the door, and I answer it. And there's like two 15-year-old girls, like 14 or 15, drinking Bud Lights out of cans, and they're like, "This is real." They're like,
"Yeah."
Hey, do you guys have any porn?
Oh, I remember now.
And we were like, what? No. And they're like, oh, we just love to watch people fuck. And then as I was shutting the door, they were like, or we could just fuck. And I like, that was, the door was just shut already.
Which should have been wide open.
I just don't think that really emphasizes the amount of awkward staring that was involved in this story.
Yeah, it was a good stare.
They're like, do you have any porn? We like to watch porn, and we're like, we like to watch people fuck.
No,
I mean, we have the internet.
There's some crazy stuff on that internet. I mean, maybe.
Like, we were just wondering.
No, we have the Drudge Report. You might be wrong. We should be rocking and just get gradually faster as I tell the story. Oh.
Call cold chambering.
We know the guys in Astrofang really well, and we heard that they've shared some stories about us that have happened to all of us together. And one that was really funny, it didn't really involve the band, but members of the band. We were all kind of like going to the same apartment, my apartment, all the time to like hang out and drink and whatnot. And I was in bed really late one night, like 4 in the morning, 5 in the morning. And my back bedroom had a door in it that led to the patio, the back patio. And to get out back, you had to go through my bedroom. And basically Christian and Brian from Astrofang and our good dear friend JB were out celebrating one of their birthdays, JB's, I think. And Christian had called me earlier, like 9 o'clock, like, hey, do you care if me and JB and Saunders come over and like hang out for a little bit? And I knew it was going to be an all night thing. And I'm like, I'd rather not, because I have company over, and didn't want anybody coming over. And so he's like, all right, cool, well, we'll just go somewhere else. So around 4 o'clock in the morning, I'm asleep, and this other person's asleep. And I hear a big knock on the back door, and I open it, and I see the three of them standing there holding a branch the size of a fucking tree. And they just have the biggest shit-eating grins on their face. They're just like, hey! And then I don't say anything, I just close the door and I lock it. And I go back to bed. And then he knocks again, and I open him like, what? He goes, we brought you a treat! And then I shut it again and didn't say anything. He's like, come on, let me bring the tree in! So I open it, I'm like, I don't want him. Before I could finish it, they're just moving it in and like chanting, like, oh, 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 and they all drop their pants down and are walking in their underwear carrying this branch through the entire fucking apartment. And the company I had wakes up and goes, what the fuck is that? And I'm like, oh, that's friends of mine bringing a big branch in the house. And they're like, what the fuck? Like, who is it? And I'm like, it's Christian, Saunders, and JB. And the last thing they said before they fell asleep was, what the fuck's a JB? And they passed out. And the next morning, I walk in the living room, hungover, and there's just this big tree sitting there, taking over the whole apartment. And then, I was pissed, and I'm like, we need to get that out right now. And then one of them goes, no, what we should do is go to Bob's and have some morning beers. And I go, okay. And then we just went to Bob's at like 11 in the morning, drank some beer mimosas, and the branch sat in the apartment for like a week and a half.
Wait, you were in your underwear, and I walked in.
You should probably take this chair for this part.
I'll tell up until you come in here. All right, so like I said earlier, we have a lot of funny stories involving a lot of the people in bands around here, and they mostly involve two particular members of Astrofang, Brianna Saunders and Chris Rory. And we always had a lot of good times over at the apartment we lived at. Everybody would come over and drink, and kind of a halfway house for people who were too drunk to drive home would always come over to our
house. Only thing on the TV was Saved by the Bell.
I would wake up every morning to repeat of when you wake up in the morning, it would go, and then it'd stop and go when you wake up in the morning, and like it did that for however long I decided I wanted to keep going on. And so one day they all come over from the previous story, Christian, Saunders, and JB. We come over to my place, and as soon as they walk through the door to my bedroom, they just get in their underwear and jump in my bed and say that they want to have a, you know, like a little sleepover. So we all get in our underwear, just sitting on my bed. The covers are over all of us. We're just like snuggled in the bed. And then we order a pizza and eat the pizza in bed. Just the four of us in our underwear hovered over a pizza box, just eating it and having the greatest time of our life. Pizza guy came and we answered the door completely naked to get it. And then after we ate the pizza, we stood outside on the back balcony, which had snow and ice on the ground, and took our underwear off and tried to throw it onto the roof of Tai 9, see if we could make it. And it ended up just falling in the alley and staying there until somebody grabbed it. So then we ate all this pizza, and then we started smacking each other with this wooden tube that I think had a poster in it before. Just a wooden tube. And we were just smacking each other with it in bed, naked. Our bodies fat with pizza and good times and slapping each other half naked, all sharing the same bed. And then and then Kevin came down. And this is before Kevin got here. Then it got even gayer.
Yeah, it gets so gay.
You gonna tell it?
No.
Alright, well anyway, he comes downstairs and we're like, hey, it's an underwear party, get in your underwear and go. He's like, alright, so he just takes all of his clothes off. And his, you know, his pee wiener hanging out. And then he joined for like 10 minutes and then he went back to sleep.
Hey, wait. The best part of that story is that
simultaneously while doing. That was the night that Eric's cousin from Alaska or something was in.
Puerto Rico.
Had no idea what
she hasn't
Eric
been to the States
like.
In like yeah. 15 years.
Her knowledge of Eric is probably just like family reunions.
Yeah,
you
yeah.
know? So like to come and she was exposed 100% to everything that was happening.
So she's like
the first time she's
couch.
Seen her cousin in a long time. She's just sleeping on the couch. And we all walk into the living room where she's sleeping in her underwear, turn on the light, and Christian goes, "Oh, I'm sorry to wake you, sweetie, honey. Listen, baby, anyway, we're going. I want these guys to hear a certain song real quick." So we go over to his record player and put on, I can't remember, it was like some like prog rock record, like King,
Yo, it was like,
King Crimson,
yeah.
I think. He's like, "You gotta hear this." And we listen to King Crimson really loud while she's laying on the couch like, what? And we're in our underwear just dancing for a moment. And then as soon as it's done, we turn the light back off and go, "Sweet dreams, baby. Have a good night's sleep, sweetie, honey." And then just went back into the bedroom. And I don't think she probably went to sleep the rest of the night.
She was probably terrified. I would be terrified.
And she didn't even see Eric. She basically just came over there to sleep and just had her experience with us and then had to leave the next morning.
I recorded astrofang up here, and and this is what happened. That's a classic. That's really good.
There's some good ones.
Is there light over there? It's all in the fine details.
There's that. Get to make sure you
can just do that. If you turn that water spigot on, I think it'll.
I think I did that. I'm not positive. Wait, where's the?
It gets better.
Yeah, it gets it.
Wait,
oh yeah, here you go. That's that page.
Keep going.
Show him the one on the
I don't know if Keith did that or if
you gotta keep going to the way it builds up to the air.
No,
that's horrible.
That's tasteless.
That one is tasteless.
Yeah. Oh boy. Yeah, there you go. It's hard to see, but Eric Clapton has a huge cock
boner, if you will.
And Jeff Beck says, "Nice dick." And of course he smiles. Ah, ha, ha, ha.
What's a big dick between friends?
Oh, come on.
I didn't know much about Tracy Morgan.
These are all just.
You're simple Hitler mustache.
Oh,
there you
go. It's really subtle.
It's real subtle. You can start from the top.
That one's artsy. That one's really classy.
Our segment's going to be so great. Here you go. Projectile. Yep. Thank you, Astrofang.
Those are all really good.
Go back.
What, did I miss something?
Upper right hand corner.
Oh.
Hold on.
Some of those were ours, I
think. Yeah,
we'll never know.
seen a different one?
Yeah.